Good morning. How is everyone? It's a nice day to be in church, isn't it? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Beautiful day outside. Very excited to be here. Very excited about a lot of things that are going on in our church. And it's just a lot of excitement going on around the church. So first off, today, the ladies are going kayaking this afternoon. Be at Warrior's Path at 2 o'clock at the ramp just past the marina. So if y'all are interested in that, Amanda will be right out at the connection table after church. Get with her with any questions, whatever you may need. She'll be out there to help you with that. Also, this Saturday, youth have a very exciting day. So if you are of youth age and want to attend this event, Lake Day is going to be this Saturday, July 29th. We're going to meet here at 8:30 and should be back around 6:30-ish, somewhere in that ballpark. 5-6? Okay, ish. 5-6-ish. All right, but those are a couple of very exciting things we have going on in the church. And also this morning, just want to share with you something I have been on my mind and heart real heavy here lately, and it's just been very exciting. It was exciting to see this video about being second, because in everything it seems like that we want to do, we all want to be successful. We all want success for our kids. We want to be successful in things, and as we pursue this, it makes us look at what we're comparing ourselves to as well. What are we looking at? What do we consider successful? What are we comparing our success to? And as I was reading my devotions this week, I come across this amazing one in 2 Kings chapter 18, and it is about Hezekiah. He is a king who rules in Judah, and Hezekiah was a unique king. And what you'll find in the book of Kings is, as you begin to read it, it's going to tell you the name of the king, and it's also going to tell you what he did. For instance, Hezekiah, it says that he did what was pleasing in the Lord's sight, just as his ancestor David did. So an interesting thing here is, one, he is being compared to his ancestor David. So the question is, what are we comparing our success to in our lives? Are we comparing it to worldly success? Or are we comparing it to godly success? Because we can be successful in no matter what situation we're in, as long as we have God in it. Let me go on down here and share a little bit more about Hezekiah. This is 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 5. It says, Hezekiah trusted in the Lord, the God of Israel. There was no one like him among all the kings of Judah, either before him or after him. So now it is saying Hezekiah is a great king, that there has not been another king before him or after him. But listen at this. He remained faithful to the Lord in everything, and he carefully obeyed all the commands that the Lord had given. I'm sorry, let me go back here. He carefully obeyed all the commands the Lord had given Moses, so the Lord was with him. And Hezekiah was successful in everything he did. Why was he successful? Because he had the Lord. He put his godly, everything that God had commanded him before his everything else in his life. He was set on God, and he was obeying what God had him do. And that is why he was successful in everything. So no matter what you're in, no matter what you're doing, no matter where you're looking for your success at, if you have God as the centerpiece, you can be successful in it. You can put God into your work life and be successful at it. You put God into your marriage, and now you're thriving instead of just surviving. God can help you thrive at everything. You can be successful once you get your priorities in line with God. So as I was reading this week, I started thinking, you know, well, what would be said about me? That was when it hit home. Would, if they wrote a book about Jason, would it be he did everything right? Absolutely not. There's going to be a lot of failures in there. Was he a great king? No, probably not. How did he compare it to his parents or vice versa? I probably have failed a lot more than they have over the course of their life. But the main thing is will they say that he obeyed the commands of his God and that he followed God in everything that he did? And I hope that when I pass on and leave this life, that as they look back over it, somebody standing over me, that they say, he was a godly man. After he gave his life to Christ, he was fully committed. And when I get to heaven, hopefully God's going to reward me with a few crowns as well. But I just want you to think about this, that this morning. Think about where you need to insert more God to be successful. Think about what you're comparing yourself to. Are you comparing yourself to a worldly success? Or are you comparing yourself to a godly success? So where do you want to be in your life? That's just been heavy on my heart, and I think it's a good thing for all of us to look at and compare. So this morning, as we worship, there's no better way to start. We're going to start with God this morning, get into the worship, put God first in it. Let's make it a priority this morning, and today may be a very successful day for you, no matter what you're doing today. So you're at the right place, so let's just pray over this today, and we'll get right into it and get started. And y'all bow with me, please. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're just so thankful for another day to be in the house of the Lord and just an opportunity to be here. And we're thankful that your presence is felt here this morning and that your spirit lives in us. Lord, we're so thankful that no matter what we put you into in our lives, we can be successful in it. It's an easy recipe. Whatever we're living, whatever we're doing, we just need to put more of you in it and we'll be successful at it. Father, just be with us this morning. Be with PJ as he brings the word. Just speak right into his heart, Lord, and give him peace of mind to just share what you give him. Lord, be with our worship service this morning. Just allow us to open our hearts, open our minds, and open our ears to hear from you this morning, Lord, that we will be focused on you and that we will uplift and praise your glorious name. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Uplift. I hope you're all having a great day and that you're excited to be here. And man, sometimes it seems like that things work out in your favor and everything goes well when we get ready to go to church, and then other times it seems like you're herding cats. And that's not disrespecting the cats, it's just that trying to get cats to go in a certain direction is nearly impossible. And sometimes at our household we got the same thing. And so when you've got a house with five other ladies. Trying to get everybody out the door, and I'm not sure how many times this morning I said, Kay, and she knows that, hey, we're ready, and, we're standing by the door ready. You got all the stuff in your hand, and it's like, I think this is going to hurry everybody along. It doesn't. And there was a part of me, I remember whenever, this is the early PJ Christian days, and I'm telling you, on fire for God, okay? I thought I was doing the Lord's work by, on Sunday mornings, being in the car, ready, and having, the girls in there, and waiting on Amanda. And I thought I was doing the Lord's work, and the name of Jesus would blow the horn to let her know, hey, this crew's ready. And she let me know that whenever she hears the horn, it slows her down. So no matter how you got here this morning, we're glad you're here and ready to hear a word from God. And so what we're going to do is that we're just going to take a minute and just say hello to everybody. So if you would just take a moment to stand to your feet, tell somebody hello next to you, shake somebody's hand, maybe somebody you don't know, introduce yourself. Thank you to those who are joining us online. We're thankful that you're here with us. And we're just going to take a moment and say hello and greet other people. Just let them know that, hey, we've been thinking about you. Maybe somebody you don't know. This is an awesome opportunity just to say hello. And what's neat about this is that you see the interaction and all. So those of you who joined us online, we welcome you to come and join us here at Uplift anytime here at Weber City. But it's great to be able to have this as a ministry that we can It comes straight into your home, or some of you may be at work. Just an opportunity to say hello. So for those of you who are joining us online, we love you. We appreciate you taking the time out of your day to join us and hear what the Lord has to say. But we just wanted to take a minute, greet everybody, and say hello and good morning. Hey, Garrison, you gonna give me five? Oh, thank you, buddy. I love you so much.
Mama always had
yeah,
the music
hey, Garrett,
on.
I love you too, buddy.
Sometimes loud, sometimes
you're
soft.
The man. Thank you guys for participating with us and taking a moment just to say hello. And, you know, I don't know, this is kind of, I think it's a good thing. And I remember being a teenager, and I despised the Right Hand of Fellowship. I did. As a teenager, and maybe you're a teenager today and you despise it. But the point of it is that relationships are important. And how do you cultivate those relationships? How do you make it happen? Well, sometimes as a teenager, you get thrown into an awkward situation. Sometimes you get put into a situation that you don't want to deal with. And I think as part of parenting, that's what we're doing. We don't want our kids to be comfortable. We want them to experience new things and to grow and mature. And there would be times that mom and dad would be gone or they'd leave for the weekend, and I could not cook anything. And so my brother was left in charge. My younger brother was left in charge of cooking. And I remember him calling me at work and said, "Hey, what do you want for supper?" And it was so weird, but he would do that. And now that the tables have turned, and man, I love cooking. But it was a point of getting out of your comfort zone. And I think it's a lot of the times of our way in life. That what the Lord does with us is that too many times we're wanting to go back to find a place that's comfortable, but the Lord can't use us when we're comfortable. He uses us when we're uncomfortable. If we only did things that were comfortable, what would we do? Somebody said nothing. That's exactly right. Every day can't be a vacation. Although when we're on vacation, we daydream about, man, wouldn't it be nice to do this every day? I know of several people who have retired. And after they retired, they went back to work. I said, "What are you thinking?" He said, "Man, those walls was closing in on me. I had to do something. And so we get out of our comfort zone, and that's where God can really, he can really use us. And sometimes we don't like the crowds, but Jesus did. These crowds were kept following him, and they were just so amazed by his teaching. And he would speak to all of them and on personally. And that's what we learned about the first week in this series in the Sermon on the Mount. So even though there were large crowds, every teaching moment was made personal. And this is kind of what I do with my kids, is that they're experiencing something new. Sometimes I put them onto a tractor. Sometimes I put them into a vehicle. Sometimes they're behind a tiller. Sometimes they're washing dishes, and then if they mess up, I'm like, okay, here's a teaching moment. Here's a time I'm just taking them to the side and say, "Here, how was that?" Well, it was scary. Okay, well, what did you learn from that? Well, I learned not to do this and to do this. Okay, that's great. And I think that's what the Lord does with us, these personal teaching moments. And that's what the Sermon on the Mount is all about, these personal teaching moments. Then the next week we learn about the Beatitudes, and it really has a lot to do with the way that we live and the way we view life and our attitude going through it, because we can have the wrong attitude. We can also get the wrong opinion or attitude towards somebody else. Be very careful where you get your input from. And then last week he really hit it home by saying, "You are the salt and the light. You're the salt of the earth and the light of the world." And we said that we need to accept that challenge that we're going to be the light. And even though you may not want people to look at you and watch you and follow you, they do. And one thing that I have learned as being a parent is that my kids have some of the exact same behaviors that I do. Let that sink in. Some of the people around you are going to have some of the exact same behaviors as you do. Growing up, all I wanted to do was be taller than my daddy, and it just frustrated me so much when people say, "You look just like your dad. You look just like your dad." I think, no, I'm not. And my goal was to not be like my dad. So my dad spent his school years working for Scott County School System. Guess where I work? Scott County School System. He was in the electronic technology. Guess where I am? Technology. Electronics. He was pastor of a church for years. Guess what I am? I am just like my dad, except I'm slightly taller. Maybe just this much. What I'm getting you to understand is that our behavior, our attitude, people are going to see, and it's going to influence others. Just think of the opportunity you have to influence the people around you. And so what does it mean to be the salt and the light? What does it mean for you to be a light to the world? This gets into the heart of the Sermon on the Mount. Before we continue, I want you to understand, when the Bible speaks on a subject, we speak on that subject. When the Bible does not touch a subject, we do not give opinions or ideas. So today we're going to be talking about some very difficult and challenging subjects. So we're just going to take a moment. We're going to pray for God to open up our hearts and ears to hear a word from Him. Amen? All right, so if y'all would, let's just pray together right now. Heavenly Father, open our eyes that we may see what you would have us to see. Open our ears that we may hear what you would have us to hear. For today is a new day, and we need to hear a fresh word from you, God. Not opinions, not ideas. A fresh word from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Matthew chapter 5. The question is, how do we be the light? And this is a continuation on from last week. And we're just going to jump right in. Matthew chapter 5, we're going to start looking at verse 21. He says, "You have heard that the ancients were told, 'You shall not commit murder, and whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court.' But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. And whoever says to his brother, 'You good for nothing,' shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. And whoever says, 'You fool,' shall be guilty enough to go into the fiery hell." Now you may be here today and thinking that you are free and clear because you are proud of yourself because you are here and not committed murder. But the heart of the message that Jesus is relaying to us is that the anger that we have, the hostility that we have towards certain people is just like committing murder. Don't pat yourself on the back thinking that I'm good, I've not killed nobody. I don't know if that was meant to be audible or not, but it was very audible. Obviously, we need to pray for one another. I'm just kidding. We all have people in our lives that we kind of struggle with. And maybe sometimes that you just send them and man, the anger just comes and you can just start feeling the blood rushing to your head. And what Jesus is saying is that, listen, anger, that type of hostility towards somebody is just like murder. It's just like murder. So your anger has repercussion. Parents, your anger and outburst towards others, not only does your spouse see that, your kids see that, the people you work with see that. They see this. And it's an example unto others. Now, the danger here is social media, because we can put out there our feelings and hostility towards others. Once you share that, it's there. Once you say something, you can never bring that back. And there's times that I have said this, I've said something, and it's like I knew it was leaving my mouth, and I couldn't catch it fast enough. Sometimes I remember being a teenager and being just smart back to my parents, smart back, and man, it was like, what am I thinking? We need to stop and think about the words and the actions that we have towards others. All this is about is the way that we treat others. So how do you be the salt and the light? Church, I'm going to give you the answer to it all. Treat others the way you want to be treated. Period. This is not what our society is teaching us. It's all about get back, get even. Blast them away on social media. You shall not commit murder. We would all agree with that. Don't kill nobody. We would all agree with that. But treating somebody so wrongly, in this case, at the point where you want them dead, look at the wording that was used there. You good for nothing? I mean, this is, he's saying you're just as guilty. Look at verse 23. This is how bad it is. Verse 23, therefore, if you are presenting your offering at the altar, so presenting your offering at the altar, this, what they were practicing back then is bringing their sacrifice to the altar. It's equivalent as today as us coming to church and praising God with our voices, with our hands, fellowship with one another. So I want you to understand, these are our acts of worship, even our tithes. That's all acts of worship. So he's saying, if you remember, therefore, if you're presenting your offering at the altar and then remember that your brother has something against you, leave your offering there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother and then come and present your offering. Verse 25, make friends quickly with your opponent at law while you're with him on the way so that your opponent may not hand you over to the judge and the judge to the officer and you be thrown into prison. Truly, I say to you, you will not come out of there until you have been paid up to the last cent. Now, to clarify this, back then, if somebody owed you money, if you lent somebody money or they owed you money for any part, you could have them legally thrown into prison until they could pay you. Whatever that was. So if somebody owed you money, they borrowed money from you, or you bought a piece of equipment or a donkey or whatever from them, and they owed you, you could have them thrown into prison. They could not be released until that debt had been paid. What he's doing is reversing the tables here. And if we're not forgiving somebody, like them forgiving debts, if we're not being able to reconcile and forgive others, it's the same thing as you being cast into prison waiting on somebody to pay your debt. This is how severe it is, the way that we treat others. It's important. It's so important. I want to speak to all you teens right now. Big ideas about your life and your future. It is important about who you hang around. They are going to develop your character. They are going to speak life into you. And a lot of times they're going to lead you down a path that you don't want to go. Be cautious who you hang around, for that's where you're headed. Now, why is that so important about this? Because of the way that we treat others. You want a group of people in your life that treat others the way you want to be treated. The reason why I'm speaking to you teens right now is because bullying is a big deal and is not to be done. You are not to prey on the weak. You are to stand for what is right. We had this conversation in our house just this week. The way you treat others says so much about your character. So therefore, it's important that we don't get our opinions of others from other people. Be very careful. Because when somebody tells you something, typically it's partial truth. Be very careful. Be very careful. And it's so serious. He says, if you're at church saying praise the Lord and there's somebody that has something against you, go reconcile. Go reconcile. This is not what our culture teaches right now. Also, I want you to note that reconciling with someone, forgiving someone, is not a weakness. Nor does it mean that things are going to go in your favor. Have you ever had to suck up your pride before? Have you ever had to do that? And sometimes that's what we have to do. We just have to swallow it and go on. Swallow it and go on. It is impossible to be friends with everyone, but we can be friendly. We can be cordial. We can treat others with respect. You can disagree on a civil matter. You can. Sometimes you have to agree to disagree and love them anyway. But our society right now is that if you disagree with me, we hate each other. That is absurd. That is absurd. Do you have a favorite color? Do you have a favorite color? I want you to turn to the person next to you and tell them what your favorite color is, whatever it is. Whatever your favorite color. All right. How many of you said that, let's say, purple is your favorite color? Just raise your hand. Purple is your favorite color. What if we said, out with the purples? Kick them out. Red is the only way. How many favorite colors? Red? Very few. Blue? Blues are winning here. All right. Tennessee orange. Who's that? You know what? We're not going to have any hatred towards anybody because that's what we're teaching on. The point is that we can agree and disagree and still love others. Man, he just said Tennessee orange. I'm not a UT fan, but I don't hate him. You know, as a matter of fact, I just told him and his fiancée just this week that every time that white vehicle or that red one goes down the road, I just pray for him. Yesterday, I seen it three times. Each time, I was like, Lord, touch them in their future. Touch them in their future. Am I going to not pray for him because he likes UT? But, church, this seems silly, but this is a lot of the world that we're living in right now, that you cannot be friends with somebody unless they agree with everything that you do. It is impossible. I love my wife. I love her with everything that's within me. But we disagree on a lot of things. We don't agree on everything. We're not going to agree on everything with everybody. Church, I want you to understand. Reconciling with somebody and agreeing to disagree is a way that we can show the love of God because He loves us despite our faults, failures, and sins. You want to be like Jesus? Give some forgiveness. Extend someone some grace. You watch what God does. He will richly bless you. All right, we got to keep going. Is there someone that you need to reconcile with? Then maybe there's someone that you're at odds with. Man, it's a great time to get that behind you. Look at verse 27. You have heard it. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. Let's pause right there just for a minute. A lot of times we want to be angry. We want to just sit there and we want to wallow in it, being angry with somebody. And then we'll come to another part here, and like in this part of saying, and thou shalt, you know, you shall not commit adultery. What he's quoting, this is the second time now he's doing this. It's one of the Ten Commandments. You shall not commit murder. It's one of the Ten Commandments. Now it's saying that you shall not commit adultery. It's one of the Ten Commandments. We'd probably say, okay. But he says on, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye makes you stumble, tear it out and throw it from you. For it is better for you to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. If your right hand makes you stumble, cut it off. Throw it from you, for it is better for you to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Again, they thought as long as they were not doing the physical act, they were clear. They were clear. But Jesus is saying, no, that's not the case. And by quoting one of these Ten Commandments, he's really bringing it home, saying all the way back at the beginning, committing adultery is sinful. It is sin, and you're not to do that. And so what Jesus is really trying to bring this to life is that it is serious to the point, not just the physical act, but even lusting. Now here, and in the way that it's written, and we almost in our society will put this towards males. Males are the ones who are doing this, but the research now shows that it's about 50-50. 50-50. Males are lusting, and females are lusting. 50-50, so it's not just about one sex, it's about both. And he's saying that if you do this, you are just as guilty as committing the act. What is he trying to get you to do? He's trying to get you to live by a standard. You want to be the salt of the earth, the light of the world? You have a standard to live by. This is a part of that standard, that you have something that you're standing for. So what is he telling us? He's saying that lust is committing adultery. And you... They were thinking, well, we're good. We've not committed the physical act. We're good. But Jesus said, you've heard it said, but this is what I say. So what are we saying to you this morning? Maybe you have an issue with lust. So what do you need to do? This is why he said, cut a limb off. Now, he's not saying if you have a problem with lusting, cut your eye out, like literally cut your eye out. But what he's saying is, get rid of whatever it is. If it's from computer images, then get rid of the computer, get rid of the cell phone, go get you a jitterbug, whatever it takes to get that stuff away from you so that even the temptation is gone. That's what he's saying, cut off. Get rid of whatever it is that's in your life that is bringing that to you. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Put some checks in place. This is so neat about technology is that we can put checks on your computer. I said we. I can help you do it. But you can put checks on your computer that it will send whoever you want to, an accountability partner, of every website and every Google search that you put in. Now, I work for the school system. And so everything gets logged. So if somebody searches for really fast cars, it logs really fast cars. But if somebody searches for, I don't even know how to say it, but something that they should not be searching for, it shows that everything is logged. And this is why, like, it has names. And you may be thinking, you know what, they can't track this down to me. They can. They can. I thought I would be special. So for a few years ago, I got contacted from the lawyers of NBC. There was a TV show that came out, and I really liked it. And I found a website that I could download every episode of every season. There's 10 seasons, 10 episodes in each season. So that was 100 episodes, and I downloaded them all for free. Uh-oh was right. So I was contacted by NBC that I was going to pay $30,000 per episode, per season. $3 million. My heart sank. And I was like, there is no way. So I ignored it. And then the telephone company contacted me with an IP address. Guess whose computer it was? My work computer. The reason why I'm going into all this detail about this is that when it comes to lust and you think that you can get by with this on your phone, you can hide, you can delete your cookies, you can delete your cookies, I can still find them. It's tracked. So if you have a problem with lust, let's talk about it. I'm not going to judge you, but I can help you put checks in a place to get that out of your life so that you can be the light of the earth, the salt. I told you there's going to be some difficult subjects. Look at verse 31. It was said, whoever sends his wife away, let him give her a certificate of divorce. This is not one of the Ten Commandments, but this is one of the practices of the law. Okay? So they took the Ten Commandments and they wrote them out. They had over 600 example statements of the law. So that's what this statement is coming from. He said, but I say unto you that everyone who divorces his wife except for the reason of unchastity makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Now this one is difficult because this is something that in our culture, divorce is everywhere. It is everywhere. And we're not talking about divorce here today. That's not the point of this passage. The passage was the reasoning behind it. They were interchanging and intermarrying so fast without just cause. He was bringing them back in to make them understand divorce was not just a free ticket just to get with somebody and then divorce. It was something that you needed to have just cause. Just cause. And with this, the one way that our culture is going against divorce is by just not getting married. Well, we'll just live together. We'll just live together. And recently, I had somebody tell me that they didn't understand the significance of marriage because all it was a piece of paper. And so, does somebody have $20? Somebody got $20? Malachi, you got $20? All right, Malachi's going to let me borrow $20. I'll give it back to you. He's going to give me 40. Thanks, buddy. $20. Now, $20, what's something we could buy for $20? Something we could buy for $20. Very little. All right, so somebody said you can get a pizza for $20. I like it on Tuesdays. All right, we get a movie. This would buy maybe two meals at Pals, maybe. Maybe two meals at Pals. Let's see. This is legit. This is legit $20. It's not fake. Thanks, Malachi. So what is the value of this? $20. Do you care? He says you don't. Just a piece of paper, right? Just a piece of paper. But what does it represent? Church, is the same thing with marriage. Marriage is not a piece of paper. Marriage is so much more. And the reason why he was teaching on this when it comes to adultery and divorce is because they were not paying any attention of the commitment that they were making for marriage. Now, again, we're not teaching on divorce. That's not the focus of this. The focus of this is the intent of what they were doing. The intent. It represents so much more. And it's the same thing with this money, what it represents. Look at what he said there. Whoever sends his wife away. I never wanted to send my wife away. Look at the wording that was used there. Where's the passion? Now, don't get me wrong. There's times that it's going to be bumpy. And the first time that me and Amanda, we hit a bump in the road, I was like, wait a minute, what's going on here? And you know why I thought that? It's because I never saw my parents fight. I never saw them argue. So whenever we had hit a bump, I was like, wait, what's going on here? But they'd done all that stuff privately. Now, I saw them have some discussions. They had some discussions, but I never saw them fight. Just because you have a fight doesn't mean you married the wrong person. Just because you disagree on pizza, where to eat, your favorite color, those things don't matter. One of the most challenging things that a couple can do is trying to find somewhere to eat. Where do you want to eat? It don't matter. It does, because when you start suggesting places, no, I don't want that. No, I don't want that. I thought you said it didn't matter. It matters. It matters. It's not the fact that they know what they want. It's the fact they know what they don't want. So what are we trying to say here, church? I'm trying to tell you that right now, if you're thinking that, you know what, instead of, you know, getting married and then divorce, we're just going to live together, we're just going to try it out. You can't just try it out. It's a commitment. That's what Jesus is saying. It represents so much more. It is a commitment. You're saying, you know what, I'm going to spend my life with you, and we're going to work through all of our bumps in a row. It's going to be hard. Sometimes we may be eating beans for 3 days in a row, but we'll do it. Sometimes it may be that it's going to be bologna for supper. But you know what? When you're together, you work through those things. And me and Amanda did it. And that's why right now I have a hard time eating bologna. I mean, I'll eat it if it's presented to me. And if you invite me over to your house and you got bologna, I'll eat it and I will not say a word. But if it's at my house, I will ask, is this what we got? But looking back at some of the most precious times that we've ever had. Church, life is not easy. Marriage is not easy. But I want you to leave here today. Malachi, your corner's burned, okay? It means something. And that's what Jesus was trying to convey. It means something. Me and Amanda, we met in December at my brother's wedding. I remember seeing her for months at Pals, and she'd be the order taker window. And for some reason, I just fumbled all over my words. I just couldn't. I couldn't say anything except my order. And it was like I was a program robot: big pal with cheese, large fry tea. And she thought I was a snob because I could talk to everybody else that worked there except for her. And I don't know why. It's just that I was just so. I just thought she was the most beautiful thing that I've ever seen. And then I would talk to everybody else. Met her at my brother's wedding in December. We went on our first date in January. And by April, we were planning a wedding. I remember telling my parents, I was like, this is going to happen. We're going to do this. I bought her a ring, but this is going to happen. And my dad, being the dad that he is, he brought us in a book. And it was like financial planning for marriage and budgeting and all that. And I remember we were sitting on the couch and this coffee table had this book, and I remember just shutting it, going, well, we can't get married. It is not happening. Mom came in there, she was like, so what are you kids doing? I was like, well, forget it, it's not going to happen. And she took that book from us. I've never seen the book since. I don't know where it is, but she took the book away and she said, if you kids want to get married, you go get married. Like, it's back on. And I still don't know what she did with that book. No clue where it's at. My point is that what she was trying to convey to us is that, listen, it's going to take more than a book to tell you that you can or you can't make this happen. It's a commitment. And what Jesus was trying to get them to understand is that their commitment, it was serious. Now, if you're here today and you're divorced, we're not teaching on divorce. That's not the point of this. I want you to understand that's not what he's saying here. What they were doing was just marrying. This is a blank, okay? They were marrying for sex, and it's just constant adultery. And trying to think they were under the rules because they had done the law, divorced, and then remarried. And what Jesus is trying to get them to understand, it's more than that. The commitment that you make to somebody, the commitment that you make sexually to somebody, means so much more. That's what he was saying. So let's sum this up. Your hatred for someone, against someone, is just like murder. Your lust is just like adultery. And have just cause for divorce. Very simple. A very difficult passage, but Jesus made it very simple. Now, how is this speaking to you today? Maybe you're here today and there's someone you need to reconcile with or you need to forgive. Maybe you're here today and there is somebody who has wronged you and they still owe you X amount of dollars and it's been 10 years ago and every time you see them, that's all you can think about. Maybe it's time just to let that go. And I'm speaking to me because there's somebody that owes me $165 from 20 years ago and I still see them and that's the first thing I think of. They owe me that money. $165. I still can't let it go. $165. And that was 20 years ago. That'd probably be like $1,200 now, right? You know what? I got to let that go. And that's what I was convicted over. So every time I see this person, I need to let that go. And maybe there's somebody with you, whether they owe you money, maybe they've done you wrong, maybe they told a lie on you, whatever it is, and maybe it's time to let that go. There's a great thing that you can do is lay that issue down on the altar. Just lay it down on the altar and say, listen, I forgive that person. Maybe there's somebody in your life that every time you see them, the anger comes out, the hatred comes out. Maybe it's time to forgive them and let that go. You're here today and you struggle with lust, male or female. We want to help you with that. Talk to me about it. If you don't want to do it here, then we can do it probably somewhere else, but let's talk about that. Let's talk about the checks we can put in and the accountability that we can help you with on your computer. If you're here today and maybe you're thinking, well, you know what, we're just going to live together and we'll do the marriage thing later, or maybe you're already in that situation, I want you to understand the serious commitment that what Jesus is talking about here. Marriage is serious. And if I would have really burnt this, you probably would be leave here today going, I can't believe he burned up $20. I just want you to understand. Jesus wants you to understand that marriage is commitment. Marriage is commitment. My parents just celebrated recently their 60th year wedding anniversary. Me and Amanda in September would come up on 22, and I told Amanda this just last night. I said, I can't wait till I can spend 60 with you. Maybe you're here today, and maybe you find yourself in a struggle in your marriage. And maybe it's time to say, you know what? Just remind each other, I'm committed to you. I'm committed. We're not going to draw this out. But the Lord has laid something on your heart that you need to bring to the altar, then I encourage you to come and lay this down. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we pray right now that you just speak to us clearly, that we may respond to your word however you see fit. Church, as you pray, the lights are turned off and it's just between you and God. If the Lord is speaking to you right now, then I encourage you right now to come to the altar and lay this down. There's something in your heart. Maybe you want to pray for you and your future. Maybe you want to pray for you and your spouse. Maybe there's somebody who has wronged you. You need to lay that person and that issue down at the altar. Then right now, the altar is open. I encourage you to come. But if your heart is beating out of your chest, if you feel the Lord moving your life, then it is your opportunity, your time to respond. Do it. Do it. Maybe this morning the person you're so angered with is yourself. Man, it's time to do something about that. Maybe you're the one who needs to be laid down on the altar. You'd pray. You'd forgive yourself. You can move forward to this life that God has got in store for you. God's not done with you yet. If the Lord has laid something on your heart, you need to come and pray. Then the altar is open. Come and pray. you have an issue with lust, it's time to pray. It's time to pray. And let's talk. Let's put these checks in place. Let's get this out of your life. Maybe you're here today, and whether you're engaged or whether you're dating or whether you're right in the middle of a struggle with your marriage, it's a great opportunity for you to pray for your fiancé or for your spouse, just to recommit yourself to one another. Say, you know what, I know things have not been easy, but I'm here. I'm here for you. The world is telling you that that it's okay. Just live together, see if it works out. What Jesus is saying here is that, listen, this is very serious. This is very serious, and that you need to take it serious. How's the Lord moving in your life this morning? This is very personal, just like Jesus was talking about, and this is between you and Him. The Lord is moving in your life right now. Someone you need to reconcile with, a hatred towards someone, an issue with lust, or the seriousness of marriage and divorce. However the Lord is speaking to you, then I encourage you to come to the altar and pray. If there's some that have already come, if the Lord has laid upon your heart, then I encourage you to come and bring that to the altar, whatever it is. There may be some of you here today, and maybe the Lord is speaking your life in a completely different way, and you just need prayer. Right now, I'm going to ask you if you would, just to raise your hand up. We're going to pray for you. Say, yes, I need prayer going on right now. Yep, there's hands everywhere. Yep, I see your hands. Yep, we're going to pray for you right now. Heavenly Father, you see these hands and what they represent, and right now we just turn them over to you and their situation. God, that you would just bless them and help them to know what to say and when to say it. We pray, God, that you would lead them through the power of your Holy Spirit as they go through their life and be the example. Father, I know that as we go through life, it's hard sometimes to be the light. And sometimes we don't get it right. Sometimes we severely mess up. So lead us, God, that we may make right decisions and point others to you. And following those times in which we do fall short, God, that we would just step up, admit our faults, and just continue to walk with you. Father, I pray for all our youth here today. God, that you would speak to them and help them, Father, for their friendships, their dating relationships. God, that they would choose right people to be around as they influence us so much. Father, I pray for every parent here, God, that you would give them wisdom and know how to parent their children. That they would lead and guide them, Father, to you. Father, I pray for everyone this morning that's married. God, that you would bless them in their marriage. I know Satan hates marriage. And one of the things he's doing right now is trying to lead people just to not. So may you touch each and every marriage here, Father. Help them through the thick and thin to carry out, Father, their vows to one another. May you bless them. And may their marriage be a light unto others. Father, I pray for everyone here this morning that's dating. Father, that you'd help them to sit down and to decide together as a couple about where they want to be, the morals they want to live by, that they may not only honor you, Father, but they may be able to be a light unto others. Father, I pray for those this morning that are hurting, whether it be from divorce or lust or hatred, envy, whatever it may be. God, that you would touch them, that they would know, Father, that you most definitely love and care for them. Father, we have been called to be the light of the world. As we leave here today, Father, and we go throughout our ways, may people be able to see you in us. May you be with the ladies today as they go kayaking, and as people watch us, Father, as we go shopping, as we go through to work this week, may people be able to see you in us. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Would you take him home and give God some praise? Amen.